cloud of dust. And so I'll give him credit for that.
Woody Hayes,
absolutely. But right, I mean,
let's end here with Aaron Rodgers before we throw Witten too far under the bus. The Packers quarterback gets to work with a new head coach this season in Matt LaFleur. But the two appeared to be out of step with each other earlier this offseason when LaFleur said he plans on limiting Aaron Rodgers at the line of scrimmage. Rodgers, though, seemingly unfazed by the audible issue, saying yesterday, "With me, I will do things that other quarterbacks just can't do or just haven't done." See, what was your reaction to what Aaron Rodgers had to say?
Well, I just need a little more on that. Aaron, does that mean if a coach calls something, you'll do what most quarterbacks won't do? You'll change the play, even though the coach told you not to change the play. To me, that's what I kind of read into it. Aaron Rodgers is a special, special talent. And as you go through the week, the coaching staff tries to do everything they can, especially for the quarterback, to make them comfortable. So you'll go through the week, and you might run a certain number of plays. And if the quarterback doesn't like that play, that play won't make it to Friday, and it definitely won't make it to Sunday. So by Friday, the offense coordinator, the coach, they can sit down with the quarterback and be like, you know something? How do you like these three throws? And the quarterback right then can be like, you know something? I don't like two of them. So they're into making the quarterback comfortable. But the audible system is the best way to make a quarterback comfortable, because if he sees something on the field, he knows he's got something in his arsenal in the playbook that he can go to compared to running that play against a defense that he doesn't like and then going over to the sideline for the coach to make the adjustment. The best teams are able to adjust in real time, and that's why the audible, it can be a problem. Defenses change too much. They change it on the snap of the ball. They change it 5 seconds before. So right at the snap of the ball, the offense, we might not know what they're doing. So the quarterback's inability to be able to get out of bad plays. Coaches teach the players on offense, you're going to have 5 bad plays during the course of the game. I might have a free runner in the backfield. Can the blitz pick up? Can the running back get there and chip him? Can the quarterback maybe throw the ball away? Now, if I got 5 bad plays, I got an audible system, maybe I can count that down to 2.
Right.
Because I put in 3 audibles, and we gash the defense. Because what defenses don't like is for them to do something specific and then us to have an answer immediately. Because defenses, if they're successful, they repeat that defense. So the audible system to Rodgers is important, just as it was to Brett Favre. And to me, I was there the day he took over from Brett Favre. The first day he practiced with all the chaos and everything, and you knew then, not only his arm was special, but he has a special football mind, and I believe they should open up everything to Aaron Rodgers.
So, but this is where, though, it has to be a two-way street to a degree. Because part of what went wrong in Green Bay over the last few years is Rodgers clearly, rightly or wrongly, lost some faith in the head coach. So early on especially, I would argue, even though Aaron Rodgers can diagnose things at the line of scrimmage as well as anybody in the league, and what he is seeing at the line of scrimmage is more informed than what LaFleur is seeing from the sideline or what anyone's seeing from the box because of his experience and just because of his perspective on the play and from being in it, the feel of the game, hearing the sounds,
absolutely,
all of that. But he still, he can't, I believe, he cannot assume that he knows all the answers and that he can't just discount what LaFleur is trying to do if for no other reason than you need LaFleur as well. We always talk about confidence as a player. What about the confidence as a first-time head coach? What about the confidence of a guy who was not, didn't have great results in Tennessee last year, but people believe he's a great offensive mind?
Yes.
He's come there with the best talent in the league at the quarterback position, of them finding a way to best work together. Like, if Rodgers is instantly, regularly audibling out of things, not because we're in a bad play and I have to fix it, but I can tweak something a little bit, that could undercut some of LaFleur moving forward. So I do feel like Rodgers has to give as well as take on this relationship?
I feel like for 99.9% of the time, that would be logic. But when you have a guy who could very well arguably be one of the greatest quarterbacks we've ever seen, don't you defer to that guy? You have a new head coach. You talk about wanting to make the quarterback comfortable, wanting the quarterback to be able to read defenses and make decisions right away for what's best for that offense. Don't you defer to a guy like Aaron Rodgers, or does that come at the expense of taking what, like Nick was talking about, the confidence away from a new head coach?
Well, no matter what level you get to, no matter what level of stardom that you might be, that being superstar, that being Pro Bowl player, all-star player, I always believe that the talent has to be submitted to the coach, because that's the way that sports are played. There's a reason why Kentucky Derby, the Preakness, the Belmont Stakes, there's a reason why the best horses we have in the world, they still run with a jockey, they still put a saddle on them, they still put a bridle in their mouth, because athletes are just like horses. They need a guide. They need a roadmap. And every once in a while, an athlete needs the coach to be able to go to the whip, to be able to get down the home stretch. So those things, talent is important. But instruction, correction, and faith in what he's hearing in his ear is the absolute best plan. So there's a buy-in. Yes, from Aaron Rodgers' standpoint, he's got to buy in. One of the problems I see, though, first couple weeks of the season, because a lot of announcers, when they watch NFL games, anytime the quarterback changes his voice inflection, they swear up and down he's changing the play. And it's not. A lot of those are dummy numbers. A lot of those, there's a reason why they call them dummy numbers.
Right, to trick the, make the defense think you're changing or.
Dennis Green used to tell us this story. Hey, when I give you dummy numbers, and one guy raised his hand and said, Coach, what are those? He said, they only for the dummies. All right, they not real. All right, so don't listen to them. So watch when they call a game. Watch how many times they try to insist. Aaron Rodgers is changing the play at the line of scrimmage. I believe that they'll be in sync. I believe we'll see the best of Aaron Rodgers. When did we see the best of Aaron Rodgers last 5 years? Two-minute situations when they're down.
Yep.
All right, when he was forced and he was doing most of the odd ones. So Aaron does have a point as far as his ability, what he sees at the line of scrimmage.
All right, let's get back to some basketball now. Talk some Kawhi Leonard.
California. He went to college in California. It's probably well known that he's probably wanted to play for a California team his entire life. I think from a competitive standpoint, he didn't want to join the Lakers because obviously you're playing alongside LeBron, you're playing alongside AD. I feel like he wanted to compete against them.
See, what would winning a title with the Clippers do for Kawhi's legacy?
Great question. I think CJ makes a good point, because last year when Kawhi demanded the trade, people just insisted that he only wanted to go to Lakers. Yes, initially, yes, it was the Lakers, his request, but it wasn't like he wouldn't go to the Clippers. And the more that you could start to see, he start to communicate, and they communicated to me, man, it's about competition, and he wants to go to Los Angeles. So I'm looking forward to seeing this, but Kawhi has a very unique opportunity, because I was looking at the players that have played the last 20 years. Man, if Kawhi wins another championship in three different places, and if he's the MVP in three different places, I don't see anyone with a better resume than what he would have than Michael Jordan. All right, Tim Duncan got 5 championships. Kobe got 5. They're 5, all with stellar franchises, San Antonio and Los Angeles. Now, I don't know what the rest of his career is going to be. Where is he going to be in scoring? How much is he going to grow his game? But to win 3 different championships and 2 of them where he was the guy, I mean, I'm just willing to hear who's got a better resume the last 30, 40 years in basketball than him besides Jordan.
So this is unique's the exact right word, because this is such an interesting question. Let's just assume they win it. Okay, because that's the premise of the question. Let's assume they win it this year. Then Kawhi will have as good of a winning legacy as anybody we've seen, as you're talking about. The legacy, and his legacy would be all about winning. He already has the best winning percentage of any player ever. He would be the first player to be, if we're taking this to its furthest logical conclusion, finals MVP for 3 different franchises. He would have be a role player winning finals MVP, a mercenary, a hired gun almost, winning finals MVP in a 1-year stop in Toronto, and then a finals MVP and championship in his hometown-ish with the team he chose to go to. That is as good of a winning legacy as we've seen. And to contrast that with a lack of individual accomplishments that we've never seen on a player of this echelon. Kawhi's only been an All-Star three times. Kawhi's never won an MVP. Kawhi's only been All-NBA three times. His career averages are 17-6-2. So to have that height of winning with that minimal amount of individual great seasons, right. He's only been a great player 3 years. He's only been a MVP candidate 2 years. And to have as damn near as many titles as you have All-Star seasons, we would have never seen that. So I don't know how you say compared to Jordan, like, I don't know how you rank him. Because what you do over the course, like Kevin Garnett, he's a 15-time All-Star, won a league MVP, won one title. Like, how would you compare that
to him? But he had to leave Minnesota to win.
Absolutely.
So there's no comparison to me. He had to join up with other players to be able to win. There's no comparison.
Well, I feel like a lot of people think that Kawhi's first title in San Antonio, when you said he was a role player.
Yeah, you can't control where you're drafted, though.
Right, but isn't that the same thing with KG?
Well, but you didn't win, though. You can't we're going to delete that part of his career and be like, oh, he was a winner once he went to the Celtics. No, you can't do that. Kawhi was drafted in San Antonio. The overall slow development to where he is, it's not like he's been in the league 10 years.
No, that's...
You said he's only been an All-Star three times. Well, how many years he been in the league?
This is going to be his ninth season, I believe, so eight seasons.
Right, and he missed one.
One season missed with injury. No, it's just so... There's nothing to compare it to.
Right.
Like, historically, where right now the guy has two finals MVPs and two first-team All-NBAs. Like, that's not usually how this works. And so... Would he jump a guy like Dirk if they do this?
Oh, come on, man. Yes, absolutely. Only thing saving Dirk is longevity, and he played 1 year. Played one championship, and he played all his years there in Dallas.
Maybe you're not assigning the importance to a double-digit All-NBA teams, double-digit All-Star games, MVP.
If you haven't been playing in the league, how can you get the double digits? You know what's important? Those three championships. You said he won. Those three championships are more important than anything else. All right? You can be 15 times All-NBA. You win one championship or no championships compared to three and two, you are the man. I don't believe there's a comparison between the two.
So let me just ask you real quick. If they win the title, you think in the Pantheon stuff, he goes ahead of a guy even like Kevin Durant, a guy who's got two titles, a final?
We need to see where they finish up, Nick. Mm-hmm. What's his overall scoring average? What's his impact the rest of the way? All right? The rest of the book's not written yet.
Right.
So Kevin Durant shouldn't be in this discussion. But as far as guys like Dirk, guys who have played the game, Garnett, and those guys, to me, there won't be any comparison. Because when they're won championships, look how much they're revered. All right? And he went to Toronto. Let's not forget that story. After missing all the season before, almost, but nine games. Then he goes back home to L.A. with AD and LeBron across the hallway and wins another one? Oh, come on, man. It's going to be hands down.
So you've already got him right now, probably, I would guess, ahead of a guy like Iverson. Because Iverson never won a title. Kawhi's got two. Got the finals MVPs.
There's no reason to compare them right now. All right? I don't have a list. I work with a guy that makes up lists. Yeah. But there's no need to compare them right now. He needs to be compared to the guys who are playing the game right now. And the guys who are playing the game, the reason why I mentioned Tim Duncan, because he just walked away. Kobe and them, they just walked away from the game, and they got five championships. LeBron's got three. KD's got two. Steph and them got three. Okay, Steph's got three. Now, if he gets three in three different places, how would you be looking at him?
Well, as I said at the beginning, he would have a legacy of winning unlike anyone we've ever seen. He would be the first guy to be the best player or win finals MVP, three different teams. He's one of only three guys to do it.
And question for you, do you discount Steph's three to the two he had to get with Kevin Durant after losing to LeBron?
Right.
So we got to start telling the whole story.
No, absolutely. But part of Kawhi's story is that when you look at his career, 17-6-2, like that's part of it as well, which makes some of the other stuff, some would say, more impressive, because he's been such a good playoff performer, because he's upped his game in every playoff run he's ever been on.
And Jenna, you'll like this. There was only a little chance he was going to join the Lakers, regardless of what was said and everything, only a little chance. And he does. In the back of his mind, in the front of his mind, he does want to compete against LeBron compared to joining LeBron.
All right, let's break there. Coming up, back to Baker. Will Baker Mayfield snap the Browns' 17-year playoff drought? Nick thinks, though. That's ahead on First Things First.
17.
Packers.